your destiny. They are seed for your next level. They are seed for your promotion and elevation. Your words are seed that is going to give you victory over every assignment of the enemy. With your words, you can cancel evil pronunciation that have held you bound for so many years. With your words, you can bring forth that which God has stored up for you, that has been waiting for you to come and call it in into your life. Your words can give you victory. A lot of us are believers. We stop speaking negatively. We stop that. We avoid speaking negatively. But something, including myself, that we are not doing enough of is we're not decreeing and declaring the blessings. We're not decreeing and declaring the breakthrough, the restoration. We're not decreeing and declaring that we are more than conqueror, that he that is in us is greater than he that is in the world, that we are blessed coming in, we're blessed going out, that we prosper in all our undertaking. We are not speaking enough positive words into our lives. It is the blessings that turn the curses around. Many of us are still on the curses, but we've not been speaking blessings that will overturn the curses. Amen. And that's what we want to learn tonight. We want to remind ourselves, because we've heard it in the past. Yes. The book of James, James chapter 3 verse 2, in the NLT version, it says, indeed, we all make mistakes. For we could control our tongues, we will be perfect, and we also ourselves in every other way. What is James saying? If we can control our tongue, every area of our lives will line up. If we can control our tongue, it means our finances will be in order. If we can use our tongue correctly, our relationship will be in the right place. If we can use our tongue correctly, our health will line up. If we can use our tongue the right way, we will eat better. All the things we're struggling with, James is saying, if you begin to use your tongue correctly, those areas will begin to change. That's how unbelievably powerful is your word. What is it that you need to be changed in your life today? Begin to use your word to bring forth that transformation. Don't use your word to describe your situation. Begin to use your word to change your situation. Don't use your word to describe your pain. Begin to use your word to call in comfort and healing. Don't use your word to cooperate with the enemy.
Amen.
If you're going to have victory in your prayer, you've got to change your words.
Amen.
The quality of your life is going to be determined by the quality of your words. The quality of your prosperity is going to be determined by the words you speak. Proverbs 18:20. It says, a man's stomach will be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth. He will be satisfied with the consequence of his words. In other words, the results of your words can bring you satisfaction. Yeah. Where do you need satisfaction?
Yeah.
What area of your life are you lacking being satisfied? What area of your life are you struggling? What area of your life are you being challenged right now? The Bible is telling us with your words you can change the trajectory of your life. Yeah. You can determine the maturity of a believer by the words they speak. You can determine that. You can tell the spiritual maturity of a person. You can take authority over your life, over your situation, by the words that you begin to speak. Amen?
Amen.
We want to be able to carry out God's will for our life. We need to begin to change our words. Yes. The scripture says a lot about words. The scripture says a lot about what happened. Even Jesus talked about it in Matthew 6:31. He says, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? What shall we wear? He said, take no thoughts. In other words, don't say, take no thoughts saying what is troubling you. Take no thoughts saying, I don't know if I will ever find a job. I don't know if I will get healed. I don't know how my miracle is going to happen. Take no thoughts saying.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
The challenge I'm going through. Take no thoughts saying. The attack that is coming against you. Take no thought saying, where wicked spirits are attacking you and coming against you. Take no thought saying, don't say it. You can think it, we all think negatively sometimes, but make sure you don't say it. Because the enemy shoots in our spirits if Job was constantly praying, worrying, fearing that his children would sin against God. And he was always afraid, always worried, always panicking, always concerned, always praying for them. So when the devil saw that area, that's the area the devil attacked him. And he said, what I greatly feared has come upon me. So you have to be careful that you don't greatly fear anything. When fear tries to come in, you got to replace it with faith. When fear knocks at your door, you got to let faith answer and say, no, no, God dwells in this place. God is fighting my battle. God is making a way. He's bringing the solution in every situation I'm going through. So you spirit of fear, you are not welcome here. There is no room for you here. I'm not the same pack you used to know last day. I'm a new pack now. So fear, go back to where you came from. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
There's a story that is in 2 Kings 5 verse 10 to 13. This story kind of describes two options and two situations where one could have brought negative results and the other one brought positive results. And it's a story about a man in Samaria. His name is Naaman. He's an officer, an important man in Samaria. He got leprosy. And so his wife's servant, who is a Jewish girl, told the wife, look, there is a man in Israel who is able to heal your husband. His name is Elisha. Let him go to Elisha. Elisha will be able to heal him. So we take up the story there from verse 10, 2 Kings chapter 5, verse 10. So when he got to Elisha, Elisha sent out his servants to meet him with his message. Go to the river Jordan, immerse yourself 7 times, your skin will be healed, and you will be as good as new. Elisha sent his servant, go tell him, he doesn't need to come in here, because the word can be sent, and the word will prosper in that which is sent.
Amen.
So this is Naaman's response, verse 11 and 12. Naaman lost his temper. He turned on his heel, saying, I thought he had personally come out and meet me. Call on the name of God. Wave his hands over the disease part and get rid of the disease. The Damascus River, Abner and Pharpar are cleaner by far than any of the rivers in Israel. Why not bathe in them? At least I'll get clean. He stomped off. Mad at it. This man, Naaman, he was speaking with lack of faith and pride. And that could make you lose your miracle.
All right. Yes. All right.
Death to life is in the power of the tongue.
All right.
But his servant said to him in verse 13, his servant caught up with him and said, Father, if the prophet had asked you to do something hard and heroic, wouldn't you have done it? So why not simply wash and be clean? The servant was the one that spoke life.
Yes.
But could have been death that could have stopped his miracle, because if he had left with that anger, he would have lost his healing. He would have received death because of his pride and lack of faith. But because his servant spoke, life came in. And thankfully, he listened to wise counsel. And that's where another area where we need to pay attention is listening to wise counsel. A wise counsel that you listen to can turn your story around. It reminds me of 1 Kings chapter 12. Solomon's son, his name is Rehoboam. He inherited the kingdom. He inherited the wealth. He inherited all the blessings that Solomon had, the 12 tribes of Israel. And when he died, he was still a young man. The elders of Israel, they went to him and they said, Rehoboam, your dad was really hard on us. He made us do a lot of work. Can you at least reduce the labor that we do? Just a little bit, just a little bit. Not much, just a little. Can you reduce our labor? And he said to the man, go and come back and I will tell you my answer. So the elder man that walked with his dad, they went to him and they said, Rehoboam, if you will really listen to these people, they'll stay with you. They'll work with you. Give them a break. And he said, okay, let me think about it. So he went to his peers and he asked for their counsel. And his peers said to him, if you do that for these people, they're going to think you're weak. Don't you dare reduce their labor. You tell them, I'll make your labor harder than my father did. Wrong counsel. Words are so powerful. If you listen to the right counsel, it will bless you. If you listen to the wrong counsel, it will destroy you.
Yes.
So when the people came back, they said, Rehoboam, do you have an answer for us now? He said, yes, I do. As a matter of fact, I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to make your labor harder for you than my dad did. And the people said, oh yeah, we don't have to stay with you. 10 tribes, he lost out of 12. They followed Jeroboam, who was a rival of his dad. The right counsel, the Bible says in the multitude of counselors, there is safety. But you must make sure you're listening to the right counsel. You must make sure the person that you are listening to know the voice of God. You must make sure you're not listening to a foolish person, because a foolish counsel will bring you a foolish result. A foolish result it will bring. Words are creative. Life and death is in the power of the tongue.
Yeah.
Proverbs 18:21. Why is life and death in the power of the tongue? Because whatever you are saying is either cooperating with Satan that hates you, wants to destroy you, or your word is cooperating with the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
And I thought the scripture, John 10:10, is really relevant to Proverbs 18:21, because Jesus said the devil only came to steal, to kill, to destroy. He said, but I have come to give you life and give you life more abundantly. Yes. So whatever you are saying is cooperating with the one who wants to kill you, wants to steal from you, and wants to destroy you, or the one who wants to give you life and life more abundantly.
Mm-hmm.
You see, if the devil has authority, he would have killed you. But he does not have authority.
Amen.
But your word gives him opportunity.
All
right. He doesn't have authority over you. If he did, many of us would not be sitting here. We would have been gone. He would have made sure we are 6 foot under, or we're in a mental institution somewhere, or we're in ICU somewhere. But he doesn't have the authority. He doesn't. Does not have the authority. He can get opportunity by what you're saying. So make sure you're not speaking what is in agreement with what he wants to do.
Amen.
Stop speaking death.
Amen.
Deuteronomy 30, 15, it says, life and death is before you. Yes. Choose life.
Amen.
Make the choice. Choose life. Begin to speak life. I'm not dying, I shall live another. I'm not broke, I'm prospering. My finances is increasing.
Yeah.
I'm developing in all areas. I'm not foolish, I'm wise. I'm blessed, I cannot be cursed.
Yeah.
I walk in wisdom. I walk in favor. I'm walking in breakthrough. God is moving in my life. God is transforming me. Oh God, you are renewing my mind. And I thank you, Father, for it. Begin
Amen.
To speak life.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen. There's a story about a group of frogs that were in the forest. A group of frogs, they were all just hanging out, moving about, and all of a sudden two of them fell in a ditch. And these two frogs started trying to jump. They were jumping, but they couldn't jump high enough. Those two frogs, they were in the bottom, and the other group were on top watching them and encouraging the two frogs that were in the bottom, encouraging them, motivating them, don't give up, keep trying, and those frogs will jump. But after a couple of hours, both the frogs on top and the ones in the bottom, they were all tired. And the group on top said to the two frogs that were in the bottom, you can just give up now. It's just too much. It's just too much. You're not gonna be able to make it. Save your effort and just give up. That's your fate. You're gonna die. And they stood there and they mourned, they were sad. And so one of them listened to the counsel of the group that were now discouraged. And so the frog said, okay. And he laid down, and a few minutes later, he died. So there was only one frog left. And so they thought, well, we can't stay here all day. Let's just go ahead and bury them, because the other one is going to die anyway.
Okay.
So let's go ahead and bury both of them. y'all were inspiring me, and what y'all were saying, it was motivating, even though I couldn't hear it because I was deaf. He did not hear the word of death. If he had heard it, he would have received it,
all right,
and he would have died too. But because he did not hear the negative word that was spoken, because he did not receive the negative word that was spoken, he was able to jump above the thing that was going to kill him. He did not die because of what he did not hear.
Amen.
You will not die if you don't listen to negative words. Your vision will not die. Your mission will not die. Amen. Your calling will not die. Amen. If you will stop listening to negative words,
yes,
your call, the call of God upon your life will prevail. Yes. In 1 Samuel chapter 17, David, his dad told David, David, go give your brothers some food there in the place of war where they're getting ready. They're facing Goliath. And when David got there, his brother said to him, then Ahab, what are you doing here? We have a few sheep you're supposed to be keeping. You don't belong here. We are real men out. What are you doing here? The Bible said, David ignored his brother and turned away from him. What would have happened if David had listened to Ahab, the one that is jealous of him? Yes. The one that has stood aside and they thought was going to be king and qualify and look like a king. He was set aside for David to be anointed. He was jealous. He was jealous. Many people that are jealous of you, that are not for you, you are allowing them to speak into your life and direct the direction of your life. I don't care how close they are to you. If it's negative, be like David, turn away from it. Because if David had listened to his brother, he would have missed his purpose. He would have missed the kingship. He would have missed his recognition. But because he did not listen to the wrong advice, he was able to be recognized and announced. That day, he brought Goliath down. Goliath are still falling. Giants are still falling. But they are waiting for your words to determine whether they are going to fall or stand. Giant, thank you. They are still falling. So based on what David did, he became one that at the end of that day, they were singing because Goliath had gone down. David killed 10,000. They were singing. People that didn't know him, they begin to sing.
All right.
Because his victory that day announced him.
Yes.
May you make decisions that will cause you to be announced.
Amen.
May your choices begin to cause you to be recognized.
Amen.
That nobody has seen you. They didn't see the trouble you've been going through. Yes. They didn't see how you've killed the bear and killed the lion. Yes. They were there when you were singing and praising the Lord.
Yes.
They were there when you were mocking. And his ears was open, his mouth was open, he was able to speak. He saw the woman that was bent over for 18 years. In Luke 13, this woman has been bent over. And Jesus said, that's the daughter of Abraham. Woman, thou art loose. And she straightened out.
Yeah.
I don't know what has been bent over.
All right.
I don't know what has caused you not to be able to look up.
All right.
I don't know what has caused other people not to see you.
All right.
But Jesus sees you as the daughter.
Yeah.
Tonight, raise up your shoulder, raise up your head.
Yeah.
God, I'm for you.
Yeah.
I am no God and I'm for you. Nobody can be against you.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
He used his words. Jesus constantly used his words, and we need to use our words consistently. Use our words. He told his disciples, he said, we want to go to the other side because there are some people that need us at the other side. And there was storm that was just raging like crazy in Mark 4, and Jesus was sleeping. You must be at peace no matter what is going on. And the disciples in fear, they went to, well, Jesus, how do you not care? And again, he came with his words. Even though the storm was raging, he said, I rebuke you.
Yeah.
I rebuke you. May the Lord rebuke every storm in our lives.
Yeah. Yeah.
No matter what. No matter what shape that storm is taking, may the Lord rebuke you.
Amen.
May the Lord rebuke you.
Yeah.
Amen.
And he said, peace.
Amen.
Be still. Be still. Financial trouble, be still.
Yeah.
Marital trouble, be still.
Yeah.
Loneliness, be still.
Yeah.
Sickness, be still.
Amen.
No matter what the challenge is, we command you tonight.
Amen.
Be still. Lazarus. Oh, Lazarus. Lazarus had died. 4 days. Jesus finally showed up. And he said, take me to the tomb. And he got to the tomb and he said, Lazarus! Come forth. You may have died. Your body may have been rotten. I'm still the miracle worker.
Amen.
I'm the life giver.
Amen.
Simply come forth. Come forth, Lazarus. I don't know what has died in your life. I don't know what looks impossible to men. But we serve a God of possibility.
Yes.
We serve a miracle worker.
Yes.
We serve a God that cannot fail.
Yes.
We serve the one who made us and is able to replace.
Yes.
We serve a God that said your latter end will be better than your beginning.
Amen.
We serve a God that is huge and big and powerful.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Call Lazarus and Lazarus came forth. Amen.
Amen.
And he still said, loosen, let him go. Jesus taught his disciples about having faith. He taught the disciples about speaking. And so as they were walking by, Jesus was hungry. And he saw the fig tree. And he went to the fig tree and he tried to pluck the fruit to eat. But the fig tree was fruitless. And Jesus cursed it. He taught the disciples, anything that is not fruitful can be cursed. Anything that is not fruitful in your life, let it be cursed.
Yes.
And so when they came back the next day, the tree was still looking like it's standing, but when there's been a curse, that curse will wither. It will cause whatever it is to wither eventually. You may not see it, by the way. So the next day when they came and they passed that by there, the disciples said, Master, the fig tree you cursed has died from its roots. Wow. And he said, yes. You too can say to the mountains in your life, be removed and cast into the sea. If you don't doubt, it will be so.
Yeah.
It will be as you have said, according to Mark 11, from verse 22 to 24. You can overturn. So there's some words that has been spoken to you. Maybe when you were young, you're such a bad kid. You're such a troubled child. You are not good. And we believe those words. But from tonight, I want you to begin to overturn those words.
Yeah.
I want you to begin to bless everything that concerns you.
Amen.
I want you to begin to bless and not curse.
Amen.
You need to begin to overturn words that have been spoken over your life.
Amen.
Begin to overturn it. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
And it is so important that we begin to speak words. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, speak to Aaron and his son, saying, this is the way you shall bless the children of Israel. This is the way to do it. Say to them, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord is gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Say to them, a blessing can only be spoken. You can speak blessings and overturn curses.
Amen.
So you must speak it.
Yeah.
The Bible tells us in Psalm 107 verse 2, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say so. Are you redeemed? And I looked up the word redeemed. The word redeemed means those that have been delivered. Those that have been brought back.
Yeah.
Those that have been set free. So he's saying, those that have been transformed, say so. You can't just think it. You can't just imagine it. You've got to what? Say so. Let the redeemer of the Lord say so. You gotta say it.
Yeah.
You gotta speak blessing. Speak blessings upon everything that concerns you. Begin to speak blessing. When you begin to bless, you're going to see your life change. You need to bless your body, bless your mind, bless your marriage, bless your finances. Bless your vehicle, bless your house, bless your clothes, yeah. Bless your perfume, bless your cream, bless your hair.
Yeah.
Bless and bless and bless and bless. Yeah. And the curses will begin to dissipate.
Yeah.
Many marriages will be saved if people begin to bless. Our finances will be different. If you begin to bless, my topic tonight is really to say, begin to bless and it will overturn the curses.
Yeah.
We are doing good in not speaking negatively. We're, all of us here, sure, you've been very careful. But I want you to begin to use your mouth to change the direction of your life.
Yes. Hallelujah. Yes.
Yes.
Bless your children. Bless your house. The Bible also talks about cursing. In Psalm 107, 109, it says, as he loves cursing, let it be so. And I started thinking about someone I worked with many years ago when I was working in an engineering company. She sits in the cubicle right next to me. And this girl will curse all day long. All day long she will curse. And everything was just going wrong in her life. All the time she curses and her life was just going in the direction. So the day I saw the scripture, I thought, no wonder. She cursed. She loved cursing and it was so for her.
Wow.
I was about to go to my office that morning and I love her. She's a sweet girl, but she curses so much.
Huh.
And so that day, I remember specifically praying, God, today I need you to use me to touch somebody's life at this office today. Before lunchtime, she came to my cubicle. She said, Pat, I want what you have. Leon went with me to Dallas. She's now in Dallas. She went to seminary school. She became saved. That day, I prayed with her. She gave her heart to the Lord. And she now is in Dallas. When Leon and I, and you were there, did you go to Dallas with us? And she came and she testified.
Yes.
And she told them how she wasn't a believer, but she came. See, our life is a billboard.
Yeah.
That day, I didn't know she saw me or, you know, anything because she was always cursing. But that day, she came and I prayed with her and she became saved.
Wow. Yes.
It is just as important to be careful what we say to people.
Amen.
And what we say to ourselves. There's something, as I was preparing for this message, I saw something that I wanted to share with you tonight, and I think it's going to make a difference. God Isaiah 58, verse 9. Isaiah 58, verse 9. I'm reading from the NLT version. Then when you call, this is God talking. He said, then when you call, the Lord will answer. Yes! I'm here!
Yes.
Wouldn't that be beautiful? When we pray, God responded immediately. He says, I will quickly reply. He says, remove the heavy yoke of oppression. Stop pointing fingers.
Yes, Lord.
And spreading vicious rumors.
Amen.
He said, if you will stop that, I will answer your prayer quickly.
Yes, Lord.
Even if those people are bad, God says, stop spreading rumors. Stop gossiping.
Yes,
stop gossiping.
Yes,
gossip, you may say, well, is it gossip? If it's true, it's still a gossip. If it's going to hurt that person, it's still a gossip.
Yes.
It's still a gossip. So we need to prevent ourselves from doing that.
Yes.
Proverbs 20:19. A gossip betrays a confidence. So avoid anyone who talks too much. Because in the multitude of words, sin is not absent, the Bible says. And James tells us in James 5:16. He says, confess your sins, your trespasses one to another.
Mm-hmm.
Pray for one another that you may be healed. The effective fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much.
Yeah.
Pray for one another that you may be healed. In other words, we need to confess our sins to one another so we can be healed.
Yes.
There are many people in the church. They've been forgiven. They are saved, but they are not healed because they're not confessing their sins one to another. Because they've done it before and they were betrayed. They talked to somebody about what they're dealing with and they were betrayed.
Mm-hmm.
And you see, the devil likes secrecy.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to overcome something, you confess it to somebody that will pray with you and you will overcome that thing.
Yes.
And what we do is, listen, I just want to tell you this. It's a secret I was told not to share, but I'm just going to go to tell you. Please don't tell anybody. And that person will go to somebody else. You know, I was told not to share it, but I'm only going to tell you. Don't tell anybody. One day, when I was teaching, I used to teach in the homeless shelters that I use in my curriculum. I was teaching at AIDS Foundation, and I decided to do an experiment. I had them all sit in a circle, and I whispered some words into one person's ear, and I said, tell it to the next person, tell it to the next person, and tell it to the next person. And then I asked the last person, I said, what was said? It was totally different from what I said. Completely different. Completely different. And it doesn't matter how many times I did that experiment, it was the same thing. So we must stop spreading rumors. You know, a person that knows something and don't say it is power. Power under control is character. It's godliness. Godliness and contentment is great gain. A person that feels good about themselves is not going to say things to make you look bad. They're not going to do that. That's not their cup of tea. It's a person that don't feel good about themselves. It's looking for something that is not good in you so that it can make them feel good. But that's not the way to feel good. The only person that can build you up, promote you, provide for you, make a way for you, is God, if you please God. Because when you're talking bad about a child of God, you are talking bad about God. You don't know their story. You don't know why they're so flirtatious. You don't know what makes them the way they are. You don't know why they behave the way they behave. But the one who knows everything about them, why they act the way they act, is the one that we need to fear. He's the one that can bless us. Stop judging. I wonder how many of our prayers are being hindered because we are pointing fingers. We need to stop pointing fingers. Amen?
Amen.
So let's be comfortable to be able to share with somebody so that our sin can be forgiven and we can be healed. Amen?
Amen.
So there must be speaking of the word. And the words that something in the realm of the spirit. And listen to what God said in Numbers chapter 14, verse 28. Say to them, as I live, says the Lord, just as you have spoken in my hearing, so will I do to you. Whatever it is that you're saying, whatever it is that you're talking about, your situation, God said, as you are saying, so will I do to you. If you are saying, I'm the blessed of the Lord, God says, I'll see to it that you are blessed.
Yes,
if you are saying, I'm wise, I'm beautiful,
yes,
I'm carefully and wonderfully made, God has good plans for my life. God said, that I will do. But if you are saying, oh, I'm in pain all the time, I'm so tired, I'm so stressed out, I don't even know what's going on with these crazy children, God said, so will I do. This wicked husband of mine, I'm so sick of him. So will I do. But we are supposed to begin to say those things that be not as though they are.
Yes.
Begin to call the man. You're a good man. You're a good husband. You will not be in the days of your life. You will not cheat on me. You will not betray me. You will love me. You will be good to me.
Amen.
It may take a while. Did I raise you? You can think it, but say the opposite.
Amen.
You're a great child.
Yes.
You're a child that will grow up, you will be an asset in the community.
Yes. Amen.
You will take care of me in my old age.
Yes.
You will marry the right woman.
Amen.
You will marry a woman that will fit into our family.
Amen.
You will not take drugs. You will not steal. You will not be a statistic. You will be a blessing.
Amen.
You will be a blessing.
Amen.
My child will be a blessing.
Yes.
You can go to your vehicle that looks like you don't know what. Oh, you this vehicle. Yeah, you will be changed. But I'm not going to be spending money on you anymore.
Amen.
You will function right.
Amen.
Until God bless me with the one that I desire.
Amen. Lord.
Fully paid for.
Yes.
My house. This environment is the sanctuary of God. The peace of God dwells here. The presence of God dwells here. There is wholeness in this house.
Amen.
There is godliness in this house. Every crazy spirit in this house, I bind to, I cast you out in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
I told you all the story about a lady that said that she was praying and she just feel like there's just all kinds of demon in her house. And so she asked the Lord, Lord, you said to bind them. I'm binding them. And God said, yeah, you bind them, all the crazy demons are still here. That's why your house is going crazy, because when you bind them, you better set them out, cast them out.
Amen.
Yes.
Because when you bind them, they're tormented, they're shaking your house, causing all kinds of chaos.
Amen.
I don't know what demons have been around you. May the Lord rebuke them, cast them out.
Hallelujah.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Why is that so important? It's okay. If they are so important, what do I do? There's a couple of strategies I want to share with you. The first one is wait. Before you open your mouth, wait. Wait. Don't speak too quickly. James said in James 1:19. He says, understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must all be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to anger. Do you know when you're speaking too fast, when you're getting angry, you get more angry, you get more mad, you get more pissed off. The talking must make the anger go away. It makes it worse.
That's true.
And when you're talking too much, when you talk too much, you feel like you need to win an argument and you argue about everything and you feel like you have to win. You feel like you have to you have to be one who wins the argument. People don't want to be around somebody that argues all the time.
Amen.
The Bible says it's better to live in the house top than a contentious, live in a house with a contentious. conscientious woman. In other words, it's better to go to the attic. You know how hard the attic is and dirty it is. It's better to be there than to be in a house with an argumentative woman. We need to stop being argumentative. Let God fight for you.
Amen.
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 You don't have to argue all the time about things. You don't have to argue to win a battle. God can fight for you. Amen.
Amen.
Be quiet. And God will do the battle for you. He will do it. He's able to do it. Amen.
Amen.
Truly, a wise person uses few words. Do you understand? It's truly wise when you use few words. And then the number two is ponder. Ponder. The word ponder means to muscle it. You think about it and muscle it and just deliberate on it. You think you without saying it. And it made me think about Mary in Luke 1:28-29. And coming to her, this is Angel Gabriel. Hail, favored one, the Lord is with you. But she was greatly troubled at what was said and pondered. What sort of greeting is this that I may be? And Mary kept all these things, reflecting them in her heart. She reflected all these things that she just heard. Mary, you're going to have a child that is born through the power of the Holy Spirit. You imagine, Mary, it has never happened. She didn't want more. Guess what? An angel just appeared to me. Mom would tell her sister, and her sister would tell her husband, and her husband would tell the whole neighborhood what would have happened to that baby. She sent that baby a lot of trouble and herself a lot of trouble by keeping quiet. There's some things you hear from God that you don't share. There is a time for every word.
Amen.
Do you know words have timing? The right timing and the wrong timing? Every word has the right time and the wrong time. I'll show it to you.
Yes.
If you don't believe me, I'll show you. Every word has right time and wrong time. Proverbs 15:23. It says, everyone enjoy fitting reply. It is wonderful to say the right thing at the right time. Words, they have the right time. And as I was thinking about who spoke the right word at the right time, I thought about Esther. I thought about Esther. Esther did not reveal herself until it was the right time. Twice she invited her enemy with the king to her house, served her food, but she did not reveal herself until the second time. And the second time when she revealed herself, she gave her half his kingdom. So anybody that wanted to tamper with his bride, he was ready to kill that person at that point. There is a right time. When the man you are with or the woman you are with just came back from work, they're tired, they're exhausted. It's not the time to say, honey, I need some money. Honey, that plot, that water is leaking. And you start to fight and argue and all this. The right time. There is a right time. Every word has the right time. If you speak the right word at the right time, you will get the victory. You will get the victory. So remember, right time and not saying things that you're not supposed to reveal yet. I thought about Hezekiah in Isaiah 39. Hezekiah is the king that God loves, and he was doing great things. And so he got sick, and God healed him and gave him 15 more years. So he was grateful, and all the other kings that were friends, allies, they were sending messages. So the king in Babylon sent message to him to say, I'm so happy, you made it. You made it, you didn't die. And he was so happy. He said, let me show you some of the treasures in the palace. I started showing him all the gold, all the silver in the house of God, in the palace. And Isaiah came in, Isaiah the prophet came in. Isaiah said, what have you done? He said, nothing. I just simply showed them every treasure in our house and in the house of God. And Isaiah said to him, everything you showed them is going to be taken to Babylon. You're going to lose them. Everybody is not for you. You don't show everything that God is showing you. You don't reveal everything you've been blessed with. Because some people are jealous, but you don't know they're jealous. And they want what you have.
Amen.
They want what you have. And I don't think God wants us to be showing off.
Amen.
Because when you're showing off, you're comparing yourself. If you compare, you feel like you're better, you're going to get prideful. If you compare, you feel like you're better, you're going to be jealous. Don't compare.
Amen.
Run your own race.
Amen.
Be your own person.
Amen.
Do not compare.
Amen.
God is dealing with us differently at different levels. Amen?
Amen.
So your words can produce a good outcome or a devastating outcome based on what you are saying. A kind word can change a person's entire being. Just one kind word. Your word has the power if it's wisely used. It has the power. Your word is powerful. It has the ability to create a moment and strengthen or destroy. Don't mix your words with your mood. Don't do that. Do not mix your words with your mood. Your mood change, but your words can never return.
Oh, wow.
It cannot return. So it's not everything you feel you express. Stop expressing your emotion if it's not positive. So remember, begin to use your words to call in the